You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download. Welcome back to Exercise 5. Now, this is subtitled Making the Mesh. But what is it exactly that we're going to be using the mesh for? Well, let's turn off our overlays by hitting the A button, and I'll use 0 on the keyboard just to turn off the outlines. Well, we're wanting to patch this wall texture over the top of our arm here and try and make this move in a nice, realistic sort of way. And for that, we're going to use Mocha Pro and PowerMesh to create a nice big distortion mesh for us, so we can get all of this lovely movement in here without having to do too much work. And let's bring Mocha Pro onto our footage, and let's just move that over here. And let's launch Mocha. Now, we're not going to talk too much about the Mocha interface. I mean, there's a time and a place for that. We do have other tutorials that go into this in a lot more detail. But the basic idea for this is that we create and track a shape around the arm and the hand that we want to track. And we're going to use the PowerMesh functionality to do it. And the PowerMesh buttons aren't found in the Essentials workspace by default. So I'm going to move into classic mode so we can see more functionality. So let's come up to my top toolbar here, and I'm just going to create a shape outline over here. And I'm going to take in a lot of the hand as well. Now, I'm not going to worry too much about being pixel accurate about this. In fact, it's going to help us quite a bit if we're not, 100% pixel accurate. Just use the X key to pan around. Okay. And I'm going to right click to close my shape up. And the X key again to pan around. So Z and X, which are frame forward and frame backwards in Silhouette, are actually Z for zoom and X for pan in Mocha. There's something very tempting about the bottom left-hand corner of the keyboard, isn't there? And if we take a look down at the bottom with the track motion options, we've seen these same track motion options when we're working with the built-in Mocha tracker in Silhouette. So the translation, scale, rotation, shear, and perspective. Now we've got one more here, which is called mesh. If I turn this on, I'll turn perspective on while I'm here. We see it's going to create an automatic mesh for us. So instead of tracking this shape as one big shape, it's breaking it up into lots of smaller subplanar tracks. If I come over to the mesh generation area here, I can change my generation mode from automatic to uniform. Hit generate mesh again, and that will create a new mesh based on my mesh size here. So that was a little bit too fine for me. Let's try 64. And I think that's going to be okay for us. We can always come in and adjust this later, but I think 64 is going to be pretty good. Now, in terms of mesh tracking, I'm going to turn on auto smoothness here, so I don't have to worry too much about what the smoothness is doing. I'm just going to let Mocha handle all the difficult decisions for me. And we come up to the viewer. I've got my tracking buttons right here, so let's just track this backwards. And you'll now see that that is sort of moving as a mesh would. There we go. If you have a little look down the bottom here, I am getting some movement along the mesh, which I don't want. This is unwanted movement. And this is something that we need to think about a little bit more when it comes to power mesh than when it comes to regular tracking. Because regular planar tracking is probably going to ignore that sort of movement and have it not affect the track at all. When it comes to power mesh, we don't want any of that stuff here. So what can we do? Well, I'm going to come up to the top of the viewer and turn off Show Track Mesh. I can just click and hold, and just so it does show points. So that should be fine. When I was drawing the initial shape, I was quite cavalier about how big it actually was, because that has some good value for us when it's making up the original mesh. See, some of the mesh points go slightly outside the shape, but they're basically using the shape here to help generate where the mesh should go to. What I don't want to do, though, is I don't want to have too much extraneous details going on around here. So before we actually come in and track the mesh properly, I can come in and move my shapes back in so that they're a lot closer over the top of the area where I want to actually track. And the nice thing about doing it this way is that all of these points that are outside of the actual shape that we're tracking, they're still going to have movement to them. That movement is still going to be of the main planar track. So it's only going to be the areas that are actually sitting within our shape that are going to have the subplanar track, the power mesh track, actually apply to them. So this is something I do whenever I use the power mesh. I make my shape big to create the mesh, and then before I track it, I make it small again to cut out any of this extraneous detail. So let's retrack those frames. I'm going to track those backwards, and let's have a look at that same area there. You can see down at the bottom, I'll just turn my mesh back on so we can see this properly. You see the problem areas that we had before aren't actually being affected in the same way this time. So that movement of the hand underneath here isn't affecting those particular mesh points. So we're getting a nice mesh being built up. Okay, so that's tracking in all rather nicely, but I'm going to start tracking this forwards here. And I'm only going to track actually a few frames, and we'll start to see a couple of little problems. So I'm going to track forwards and hold my finger over the escape key, because that's what we're going to use to stop the tracking. Okay. Right, and it didn't actually take that long to see that our power mesh has started to go a little bit strange. And that's because our hand is coming in and messing everything up. So what we need to do is tell Mocha not to track this hand here. And we're going to do that using something called a track mat. Let's just turn off visibility and the process cog on here so we can just focus on what we need to do. Because a track mat is just another layer that we're going to use to cut out any layer underneath it. So if I come back up to my toolbar here, come into the ellipse tool and just draw around my hand. I'm going to keep this quite loose because I want to make sure that things like shadows are not being picked up at all here. And I'm just going to quickly track this through. So let's turn off shear, and we'll keep translation, scale and rotation turned on. And we'll just track that quickly through. This track doesn't need to be very accurate, because we're just using this as a way of like cutting out the data underneath it. This can be quite sort of loose, and it's going to be fine and work exactly how we need it to. There we go. Now that's tracked through. The only thing we need to check is to make sure that we don't have any pixels poking through that could throw off our power mesh. And that could easily be little things like shadows here. So I'm much more willing to make bigger shapes here that mean that the accuracy overall is going to be a bit stronger. And again, we'll look here, just check for any shadows to make sure that no shadows are going to be sort of poking out, because all those little things could actually help to throw our track off. I don't want to make this too big, having said that, because we still want to get a nice accurate track underneath it, but we want to sort of take out those small shadows. And again here, and again here, we'll just poke that up there and bring it down when the fingers come back down. Yeah. Okay, that's tracking through nicely. And the nice thing about track mats is that I actually don't even need to track them if I don't want to. I can just manually animate things if I need to. So here, again, just make sure that shadow isn't being counted. And then we can bring that out where it needs to go, around about there. So here, all of this shadow area could be throwing off the power mesh when that hand comes in. We definitely don't want that. All right, okay, so now we've got our track mat sorted out. I'll call this one hand track mat. Let's turn the cog off on that, and we'll turn the visibility and the cog back on our track. And let's retrack this, the mesh. Make sure we've got the power mesh turned on, and let's track this forwards. Cool, and let's play this back. And we see we're getting nice movement within that power mesh now. Now, before we take this data out to Silhouette, here's how we can check to see what it's doing. I'm just going to come up the top here and just turn off the overlays completely using the little screen button up here. And let's come down to Stabilize. And I'm going to turn on Mesh Warp. And I'm going to make sure it's set to Unwarp. And we'll set the value to Normal here. Let's turn off the final overlay up the top there. And I'm just going to play this forwards. And if our tracking's right, what we should get is a really nice stabilized arm here. So everything else can be moving around and looking, you know, weird and wonderful, but our arm itself should generally be really static. And that's exactly what we've got here. So I'm very happy that the data that we've got for our power mesh is actually going to be usable and workable when we bring this back into Silhouette. So let's save the project, clicking the big save button, and go File, Exit. And now we're back in Silhouette again. So we've done quite a bit now prepping our shot with the power mesh data that we need. We looked briefly at the Mocha Pro node, how we set up our power mesh, and how to use track mats to make sure that we're not getting extraneous data come through when objects start crossing over into our mesh. If you want to learn more about power mesh, then head over to the BorisFX website, where we have quite a few standalone tutorials that go through the process of getting the best results with PowerMesh in Mocha Pro. In the next part of this exercise, we are going to start to use this data to move the wall texture over the top of the arm and start to build our composite. So join me again after the break.